Dear learners, welcome to the NIO studio. I'm Dr. Shivani Datta from University of Delhi, and I'm here to talk about early childhood care and education. And in this lesson, we would be talking about developmental delays and significance of early interventions. Now, in the prior modules, we've already discussed the importance and significance of early childhood care and education. Now, early childhood is actually defined as the period between birth and 6 years of age. And there are researchers that have clearly established that the growth and development in this phase is very rapid. So any kind of delay or any kind of disruption in the growth and developmental pattern in this phase can have serious implications for the overall growth of the child in future. What do we understand by delays and milestones? Now, children under normal circumstances are expected to achieve certain milestones in their respective domain. You could be taking any domain, for example, sensory motor. Now, we all know that more or less by the age of 6 months, the child is able to sit without support. Around 8 to 9 months, the child can actually stand up using certain support. And around the age of 11 or 12 months, the child is able to take the first step. And around 13 to 15 months, most of the children can walk independently and confidently. So these are certain milestones which are predictable, and more or less every children goes through these developmental milestones. So it is expected that certain competencies would appear at a particular age. These are called the developmental milestones. Now, what is a delay? If children lag behind the normal pattern of growth, they may be having a developmental delay. Now, these developmental milestones are not restricted to only physical functions, and it pertains to almost every domain that we have studied so far. So, be it cognitive domain, language acquisition, socio-emotional, etc. For instance, some of the early milestone examples could be the first social smile. So we all know that babies, when they are born, right after birth, they are capable of giving different facial expressions. Could actually look at the baby who's smiling for no reason, a baby who suddenly frowns for no reason, a baby who suddenly gets afraid for no reason, or starts yawning, or starts making disfigured expressions for no rhyme or reason. What is a social smile? Social smile is considered to be a very important developmental milestone because this is a smile which is not occurring randomly. This is a smile that baby is giving in response to some sort of an interaction initiated by you. So when you talk to a baby, or when you laugh, or when you smile looking at the baby smiles back. So this kind of interaction that happens is termed as a social smile and is considered to be a very significant developmental milestone. Or maybe the first words of the baby. So the baby babbles, the baby coos, and eventually the baby comes up with first few words. This is again a very important milestone in the language domain. Or the first steps that the baby would be taking, as we've already discussed. These are certain milestones that the babies would be achieving in almost all the domains within a specific time period. Now, early developmental delays occur when a child does not reach that milestone at the expected time. For instance, the child is already 2 years old, but the child cannot stand. Now, this suggests a delay because we know that the child would be able to stand more or less around the age span of 8 or 9 months of age. The child can actually hold on to something and try to stand. So if the child is not standing till he or she is 2 years of age, this is suggesting some kind of a delay in the sensory motor functioning. Other developmental delays at times become apparent only when the child is a little older. For instance, school-age children may fall significantly behind their peers in skills like reading, writing, etc. So certain formal skills like writing, they would become apparent and visible once the child starts going to school. Then you realize that your child is not writing properly or is not able to read properly. So these are certain developmental delays that are not apparent during the initial few months and get apparent only when the child starts going to school. Now, that we know what are developmental delays and why achieving developmental milestones in a time frame is important, it is very important for us to understand what are the reasons behind developmental delays. So one of the reasons behind these delays could be heredity. We've already discussed about the importance of heredity or your genetic endowment. So sometimes at the level of genetic makeup or at the level of chromosomal makeup, there are certain complications. We've already discussed that human body or human being is made up of, they are made up of 46 chromosomes. You get 23 from your mother and 23 from your father. So you have 23 pairs of chromosomes. Sometimes these chromosomes are more than 46. That is a problem, and that leads to certain detrimental growth and development related issues. For instance, Down syndrome. Similarly, certain complications during pregnancy can also lead to developmental delays. For instance, hypertension in expecting mother. Now, what is hypertension? Perpetual increase or continuous increase in the blood pressure exerts a lot of pressure on the growing fetus, which may lead to significant developmental delays. Or sometimes mothers, they contract gestational diabetes. Now, during their pregnancy, they become diabetic. And because of this condition, certain effect on the development of the fetus can be witnessed. The second important reason could be complications during childbirth. When the child is passing through the birth canal, the passage, if it is traumatic, leads to developmental delays or could lead to developmental delays. Similarly, there's a condition called asphyxia. Now, what is asphyxia? Asphyxia is called oxygen deprivation. So if there is traumatic birth, if because of some reason or the other, the oxygen supply to the growing fetus got obstructed, this could lead to severe detrimental effects on the growth of the fetus and could eventually lead to developmental delays after birth. The third important factor is illness or malnutrition. We've already discussed the importance of nutrition and health with respect to the expecting mother. So if the expecting mother is not well fed, is not having a balanced diet, is exposed to certain harmful chemicals, radiations, etc., there is malnourishment or contracts any kind of infection or disease, then that has an impact on the growing fetus because it is the mother's womb that is having the fetus. And whatever nutrition the fetus is obtaining is through the mother's bloodstream, via placenta. Placenta is a structure through which the growing fetus receives nutrition and nourishment. So it is very important for us to take care of the nutrition and health and well-being of the expecting mother, because any kind of lapse during that stage can have long-lasting impact on the development of the baby. And another factor is accidents after birth. So these are certain prenatal conditions that we've spoken about, you know, the conditions during pregnancy or the heredity or the genetic endowment or the illness or the nourishment level of the mother. These are prenatal conditions. Prenatal means prior to birth. There are certain postnatal conditions also. That means right after the child is born, accidents after birth, some sort of a head injury or a brain damage could also lead to developmental delays. We've already discussed that your brain is a very complex structure which has different zones or lobes dedicated to different functioning. If any kind of head injury or trauma leads to a damage of a particular structure, it will have a bearing on the child's subsequent growth and development. Now, what are the physical markers now that we have talked about the concept of developmental delays and why it is important that we need to keep a check on developmental delays? It's very important to understand that there are certain physical markers, some sort of a checklist that should be there with us so that we could ensure that if our child is showing any signs of developmental delays, that is taken care of well in time. For instance, you need to know or you need to keep a tab on the baby's height and weight, whether the growth is happening properly or not, the change in body proportions, whether that is happening or not, the abdominal or the bowel movements, the urine, the stool examination, the functioning of the sensory organs. We've already discussed that we are blessed with 5 sensory organs, your eyes, your ears, your nose, your tongue, your skin, whether that is functioning properly or not. We need to keep a checklist of all these physical markers in order to ensure that the child does not suffer from any kind of developmental delay. Now, why these physical markers are important? These physical markers are important because the initial development of the child happens at a sensory level. So, if the child is not getting adequate sensory stimulation, subsequent development gets impeded. Example, if the child does not move around because of poor sensory motor coordination or poor sensory motor development, then chances are very high that the child would not be able to interact and mingle with his or her friends, may not be able to go out in the park and play and engage in outdoor sports or activities. As a result of this restricted environment, the subsequent cognitive, language and socio-emotional development also gets impacted, because in a way the child's environment is getting restricted and contained. And it is very important during the early years that adequate stimulation is provided, because your brain is expanding. So, quantitatively speaking, the neurons or the nerve cells are multiplying. But like I said, that's half the story. The other half is, if they are multiplying, they need to establish a connection and interaction with each other. If the neurons are not exchanging messages or not exchanging information, then integrative growth and development cannot happen. And for that, sensory stimulation of all the sensory organs with conducive environment is very important. So that's the reason we have to keep a check on sensory and physical impairments. If the child is not able to hear, for instance, you can't expect the child's language development to happen, because there is nothing that is going in the form of linguistic stimulation. So if linguistic stimulation is not even happening, that capacity or that faculty will not develop to that extent. And since we have already discussed in early childhood care and education, the thrust is on the early childhood, which is from the birth to 6 years of age. The reason being that the growth and development in this phase is very rapid. It is very important to detect the delay as early as possible, because any intervention later on will not be sufficient. Now, since I have mentioned the term interventions, what are interventions? Early intervention means taking necessary actions as early as possible to work on children's developmental and learning needs in order to reduce the effect of developmental delay. So, anything that you are doing in order to reduce the effect or reduce the limitations imposed by developmental delay would be termed as interventions. It's very important to realize the significance of early detection and early intervention for the holistic growth and development in children. So, if any form of developmental delay is detected, then immediate intervention in the form of corrective measure and appropriate stimulation is required, because children tend to catch up very easily. So, if you actually witness any kind of delay in your child, it is important for you to spring into action and provide appropriate stimulation, because they catch up or they recover very quickly. For instance, if there is a delay in language acquisition and you feel that your child is not able to grasp language properly, or is not uttering words, or is not able to form sentences, simple or complex, then the child should be explicitly introduced to phonemes or the sounds. You know, basic sounds like a, ba, ka. These should be introduced through videos and audios, through engaging stimulation. You should be sitting with your child, be engaged in activities, read out stories, watch videos together, listen to audios together, and they should be encouraged to repeat the sounds aloud, so that they are able to catch up the delay in language acquisition. So, in this lesson, we have learned about developmental milestones and delays and why early detection and intervention is important. In this lesson, it has also been highlighted that as parents or caregivers or elders, one shouldn't be losing hope if there's any child in the family who's experiencing developmental delays, because with appropriate interventions, the effect of these delays can be reduced significantly. Thank you.